Hi, I'm Little Pooh. I live in your radio. This is my dog, Sugar Bear. He lives in here, too.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time, and I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dragnet, their job, to enforce the law and preserve the safety of decent citizens. Decent citizens. Decent citizens.
Here we go again. Listen very carefully. You haven't got the slightest clue what these people wearing badges are doing to innocent people all over this country. And you have no conception of the depth of the well of corruption that they have sunk into. It's so deep, I don't know if it can ever be climbed out of. Roger Wiedner, former head of the Oregon State Department of Consumer Fraud, former county prosecutor of Multnomah County, where Portland is located, is currently, ladies and gentlemen, in the Oregon State Psychiatric Hospital. Apparently, because he knows too much. 75 days ago, Mr. Wiedner was convicted by Judge Dorothy Baker. I should say committed. He was never convicted of anything. Never convicted of anything. He was committed by Judge Dorothy Baker. Mr. Wiedner was in the process of charging the judge with corruption in a case involving the theft by various crooked judges of a $35 million piece of property that Mr. Wiedner was a trustee of. Roger has tried repeatedly to charge these judges, and in several cases they have just run out of the courtroom to avoid his charges. He's now been held for 75 days without a set court date in violation of the law. Apparently this could go on indefinitely. He has been allowed to talk to the Jameson White show for 15 minutes a day. And this is only because they don't realize that he's calling a nationwide talk show just yet. He has said that he is now being subjected to some kind of medical tests involving drawing blood and injecting some kind of dye for a brain scan, and who knows what else is in that needle. He has requested that his doctor be present during these tests, but they are refusing. If he refuses to take the test, they tie him down and perform them anyway. Those who know him say that he is a very determined fellow. He's stuck with this case for some 5 years. He is not crazy, and the whole thing is reminiscent of the Soviet gulag in the United States of America. Patriots are being picked up off the street all over the country, are being taken to mental institutions, and are being committed.
Dragnet. Their job, to enforce the law and preserve the safety of decent citizens. Decent citizens.
John Wilfgram from one of the adjacent counties was arrested last week by the Department of Justice and spent 3 to 5 days in jail. What are his crimes? Ladies and gentlemen, he is a constitutional defender, a member of the Fully Informed Jury Association, the first to join the El Dorado County Militia. He represents a nurse from Louisiana. Her name is Connie. Seventh-day Adventist and militia member who signed a complaint for redress of grievances as a witness attesting to the validity of a friend's signature. When ordered to produce Connie by the Department of Justice, he requested a copy of a warrant and told the female Department of Justice officer there was a violation of Connie's First Amendment rights. 40 seconds of silence and a click on the other end of the phone. The warrants were produced subsequent to the arrest by the Department of Justice. What we have here, ladies and gentlemen, is the attempt to commit crimes by the court against these people who are doing nothing but performing their rights protected by the Constitution in the pursuance of justice, and they're in jail. For what? For what? For signing a complaint for redress of grievances as a witness attesting to the validity of a friend's signature, and the other for representing the person who did it.
I hear you, man.
Briefly put, ladies and gentlemen, its agenda is that the federal government has created a mass of unconstitutional agencies that are prying into and seeking to control every single aspect of American life, and this is spread down even through the state, through the county, and into the local law enforcement agencies. And that the original balance of the Constitution must be restored if the country is to remain free. There's a war on drugs. You've heard about it. I know you've heard about it, a war on drugs. Yet the drugs are never stopped. And each day we find more and more of our liberties are gone in this war on drugs. Now, what do you suppose that means? Do you think it's really a war on drugs? Or really a war on liberty? Prohibition, folks, is in itself a violation of rights. And if you don't understand that, you don't understand liberty. But its failure has encouraged the federal government to other more serious violations in their claim to be performing a war on drugs, when in fact, it's a war upon the Bill of Rights. Perhaps the most obvious of these is civil asset forfeiture. This allows, folks, the authorities to freeze the allegedly tainted assets of an accused person prior to conviction. And until not too long ago, they didn't freeze it. They just took everything. And within 24 hours, in many instances, it was auctioned off. In any case, nobody who ever had their assets seized ever got them back, to our knowledge. Such assets can be recovered, they say, but only if the accused sues for them and can prove that no illegality was involved in their acquisition and use. But you see, if they have all your assets, your money, your property, your home, your cars, your RVs, you don't have the money to sue. And very few people that I know of ever have. No lawyer will talk to you if you don't have assets. They don't like to go against Uncle Sam, even when you do. Since this is a civil process, there is no constitutional bar to reversing the burden of proof. Do you understand? Moreover, since all assets may be frozen, the legal assistance needed to recover them is unattainable. Even otherwise, an American litigant must pay his own costs regardless of who wins. If it's long and drawn out, the cost to get your assets back could eat up the value of all the assets returned, if any were ever returned. The effect, ladies and gentlemen, is that only a very wealthy accused who wants to recover very substantial assets can be expected to sue the federal government. And they know this. That's why they do it. For everyone else, forfeiture is punishment without trial, seizure without just compensation, all unconstitutional. But what do you care? You see, most people don't give a damn until it happens to them. Then they wonder why nobody else cares. Well, I ask you right now, why don't you care right now what's happening to other people before it happens to you, like I do? Never mind that a jury may acquit or even that all charges may be dropped, assets frozen are nearly always assets confiscated, and in most cases, charges are never filed. It is, ladies and gentlemen, however, the use of asset forfeiture that has made it a weapon of arbitrary power, and even your local police get a cut of the action. Anything seized is divided up amongst the agencies, police departments, bureaus, and organizations involved. Sometimes it even goes to the officers in some cases. Bet you didn't know that. Depends upon the law in the state and in the locality and the particular crime that they're dealing with. If it's a crime at all. There have been many cases where property has been seized just because those seizing the property wanted it. Arbitrary power, introduced as a last resort weapon to nail Mr. Big, it has been extended to cover virtually every crime and every person, and there are now hundreds of federal and state agencies empowered to freeze and seize assets. The value of assets forfeited per year was $27 million in 1986. $644 million in 1991, and is now well past $1 billion. Billion with a B. And most forfeitures have nothing to do with Mr. Big. Consider this. In 1992 in Iowa, a woman accused of shoplifting a $25 sweater. Now notice, I said accused, not convicted, accused of shoplifting a $25 sweater, had her $18,000 car, especially equipped for her handicapped daughter, seized as the getaway vehicle. It was never returned. In December 1988, Detroit drug police raided a grocer's shop, but found no drugs. After dogs reacted to three $1 bills in the cash register, the police seized $4,384 and the shop safe. This, even though over 90% of all cash circulating in the United States shows some drug residue. In other words, if they want you, all they have to do is sniff your money, and you're gone. In 1994, ladies and gentlemen, a California farmer accidentally ran his tractor over a protected rat. That's right, rat, R-A-T. The United States Fish and Wildlife Service seized his tractor worth over $50,000, closed down his farm to farming, and put the man in the poorhouse. He couldn't even see this stupid rat. There are proposals to extend asset forfeiture still wider so that seizures may be made on mere suspicion and so individual officers can keep part of what they seize. This has already been done. They're already doing that. And that's all they need is suspicion. Somebody can call the police in your hometown and tell them that you're a drug dealer. And by morning, they can have everything you own seized, locked up, out of your hands. Armed with these powers, the authorities are able to do almost as they please with any person or group they dislike. They only need bother themselves with due process when they want to put somebody in prison.
Dragnet, their job, to enforce the law and preserve the safety of decent citizens. Decent citizens. Decent citizens.
And, folks, there is the gradual abolition of the right to keep and bear arms. You've heard of that, haven't you? Gun control, gun registration. They're already breaking the law. They're registering guns all over the country, and they're not even supposed to be doing that. It's against the law. They've already got over 60 million gun ownership records computerized. Contrary to received opinion, American citizens have no absolute right to own guns. There's a long history of control, and the federal authorities seem to be planning still more. That's their interpretation. The second article in amendment, the traditions and history of this country said the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. And they have no conception of the resistance they're going to meet when they try to confiscate the guns of the American citizens. In a 1994 questionnaire, American servicemen were asked if they would fire on civilians if ordered to enforce a federal ban on firearms ownership. When this question was leaked, the authorities first denied everything and then claimed it was purely hypothetical. And the commander from the postgraduate school in Monterey, California, naval commander, claimed that he was writing his thesis on the subject and had just queried one group of Marines at 29 Palms Marine Base. The truth is, we have found absolute proof that at least four different groups of servicemen and women in four different locations were given the same questionnaire. And there's nothing hypothetical about the Lamplaw case. In May 1994, agents of the Federal Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and the Internal Revenue Service, I should say the alleged Infernal Revenue Service, entered and searched the Pennsylvania home of Harry and Teresa Lamplaw. Though the Lamplaws fully cooperated, opening safes and cabinets as asked, they were repeatedly threatened with a machine gun, and three of their pet cats were killed, stomped to death in front of their eyes. Their furniture was smashed, and papers and food were mixed and scattered everywhere. Mr. Lamplaw, who was dying from cancer, was throughout denied access to his prescribed medicines, which were emptied on the floor and walked over repeatedly. The reason for this search, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Lamplaw is a gun show promoter. Completely legal, never has done anything illegal. These gatherings are common outlets for anti-federal sentiment, and so he was targeted. Among items seized was a list of all gun sales assisted by him since 1988, and you can bet they're part of the 60 million registered on that computer database, giving the names and addresses of 70,000 people. Some of these people have since had their homes searched. Mr. and Mrs. Lamplaw have received anonymous death threats for complaining.
One said his name was Fricassee, the second Cordon Bleu. The third was Cachetoris, and the fourth they just called Stu. They could have been dangerous having grown big on heavy water, but they decided they would live their lives on the side of law and order.
Still worse, ladies and gentlemen, the federal authorities have started to murder people who make too public a show of collecting arms. Arms meaning guns. At Waco, they gassed or burned to death almost. Well, let me put it this way. Over 80 people died in that conflict, including 4 BATF agents. They gassed or burned to death 67 adults and at least 17 children. In 1992, they entrapped Randy Weaver, another gun collector, and shot and killed his unarmed wife and child. Now, the child, the 14-year-old boy, or the 13-year-old boy, was armed. But he was shot in the back as he was running away. Randy Weaver was acquitted of any wrongdoing in a trial by a jury of his peers. And the hearings are being held, and you can watch them on C-SPAN probably as we speak. Lon Horiuchi, the murderer, the scum-sucking pig murderer, refused to testify to Congress and took the Fifth Amendment. This is the guy who didn't give a damn about the rights of Randy Weaver or his wife or his family or what he did to the minds of those children when they watched their mother lying on the floor dying in front of their eyes, still clutching her small baby in her arms. They had to pry the baby out of her arms, so strong was that mother's love. Next, in New Mexico, in September 1991, a small federal army composed of some 60 agents from the BATF, the Drug Enforcement Administration, DEA, the National Guard, and even the U.S. Forest Service arrived in the living rooms of Mrs. Cena Brush and two neighbors just before dawn. Can you imagine? Can you imagine this happening to you? Mrs. Brush and her daughter were handcuffed and forced to kneel in their underwear. In their underwear. While these big, brave, America's finest searched their house for drugs and literally tore it to shreds, not one single illegal substance was located. No apologies were made. No repairs were made. They just left these two terrified women kneeling on the floor. And the only act of kindness that they performed was to remove the handcuffs before they left.
Dragnet, their job, to enforce the law and preserve the safety of decent citizens. Decent citizens. The Hour of the Time, folks, is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. The only people that I can honestly recommend that will do right by you. That I can back with my own personal guarantee, even though they have their own guarantees, and even though they record everything so nobody can lie about anybody. And even though they have a buyback policy, I still need to put my name behind whatever I do, whatever I back, whatever I sponsor. And I do. Always. You're going to need some protection. Now, don't take my word for it, folks. Read the last issue of Veritas, number 5. It was our special money and finance issue. And if you can read that and not understand money, then we've really done something wrong, and I want to know about it. Also, Stephen Jacobson and I in Swiss America Trading have entered into sort of a partnership here to produce more good, fine, educational tapes and information that will keep you on the cutting edge of what you need to know to survive what's coming. Do you know that approximately 60% of the manufacturing capability of the United States has left the country? Do you know that Ford and Chrysler, no sooner did they finish cementing diplomatic relations with Vietnam than Ford and Chrysler announced that they were opening plants in Vietnam? The average worker in Vietnam earns about $4.50 a week. Do you understand? I don't think it's really hit you people yet. America is going to become the service economy for the world. This is going to be the place where everybody comes to play. And you're either going to work in Disneyland or McDonald's or for a movie theater chain or an ice skating rink or something. Because that's all there's going to be. This is going to be the entertainment capital of the world. Mark my words. And nobody in the entertainment business except the owners and the stars get paid very much money at all. Look around you. You can already see it happening. Take a good look and then call our sponsor, Swiss America Trading. And ask them how you can get your hands on some real money to at least protect and save a part of the value that you've worked so hard for all your life. And so that you can protect yourself and your loved ones.
The biggest crash in the history of the world is coming. You see, socialism cannot have a middle class. Socialism has to have a level playing field, ladies and gentlemen, which means that all the third world nations and their standard of living is going to come up a little bit, and ours is going to go down a lot. A lot. Until everybody is on an even playing field. Americans are going to lose big time unless we can turn this around. These globalists aren't joking. And New World Order isn't a phrase that George Bush just pulled out of the air. So call Swiss America Trading, 1-800-289-2646. And while you're at it, thank them for sponsoring the Hour of the Time. You'll get VIP treatment just by telling them that you're a steady listener. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. You'll be glad that you did. Believe me, ladies and gentlemen, there will become a day that you will be so glad that you did that it'll probably cause you to just sit down and cry. August 25th, 1992. Drug Enforcement Agency, DEA agents. Drug Enforcement Agency, DEA agents. Drug Enforcement Agency, DEA agents. You're not going to believe what these clowns did. You have no conception of what they're capable of, do you? They invaded the home of Californian Donnell Carlson on the claim that they were looking for illegal drugs. Mr. Carlson was asleep at the time. He thought robbers had broken in. They never announced themselves. They were wearing their Ninja Turtle suits. Or is it chickens? I forgot which. They didn't yell, "Police." They just invaded his home. He's asleep. He woke up, thought robbers had broken in, dialed 911. This guy dialed 911 and reached for his gun, and they shot him many times, riddled him with bullets, and he spent 7 weeks, not just in the hospital, folks, but 7 weeks in intensive care. And he'll be crippled for the rest of his life. He's an invalid. No drugs were found. In October the same year, DEA agents paid a similar visit to fellow Californian Donald Scott, this time bringing in the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department for extra protection. Woo! The DEA needed bodyguards, so they got the LA County Sheriff's Department for extra protection. Against this dangerous Mr. Scott, busting into his house while he was asleep, a deputy sheriff shot and killed him. Again, no drugs were found. He had no gun. He had done nothing.
Kung Fu Chicken.
Yeah, folks, anything they want is easy pickings. In Malibu, California, a 30-person raiding party of sheriff's deputies. 30 people. 30! Big, brave, macho men. Oh, yeah. We don't need no stinking badges, Mom. Federal drug agents and the California National Guard. The National Guard broke into the home of Donald Scott and shot him dead. Scott, it turns out, folks, was a reclusive man. He was the only one there. He was the heir to a European fortune whose $5 million, 200-acre ranch was targeted by federal agents under drug forfeiture laws. No drugs or marijuana plants were ever found. But an alert Ventura County prosecutor, Michael Bradbury, did find that the raiding party had an appraisal of Scott's ranch, along with notes on the sale price of nearby property. You see what I'm talking about? Scum-sucking, Gestapo, Nazi, jackbooted, puke-faced thugs. Thieves. Do you understand what's happening, ladies and gentlemen? Gideon Kanner, a Los Angeles law professor who has examined this case, concluded that the feds thought Scott might have a wife who indulged in drugs and decided to see if they could bag a $5 million piece of property for the Treasury on the come. On the come. Scott, awakened from sleep by the sound of his door crashing in, made the mistake of walking out of his bedroom with a gun in his hand, thinking burglars were there. The military force got off with a self-defense plea. You're not safe. You think you're safe. You're not safe. And folks, it's not burglars that you have to worry about unless you live in the poorest part of town in the ghetto. And you shouldn't have to worry there. But you see, that's the least place where police give protection to people. Every place else, they're stealing from you or killing you. Now, these mini Wacos do not make the evening news or capture the attention of Mr. Hunt and our much-touted investigative journalist, Dan Rather. Dan Rather not tell the truth. Communist News Network. Ted Turncoat and his wife, Hanoi Jane. The work of some BATF and other government agents, as we can see, is indeed dangerous and more frightening than any threat from any other quarter. Louis Katona of Bucyrus, Iowa, I should say Ohio, concentrating on trying to pronounce Bucyrus, and I'm not sure I did it right, B-U-C-Y-R-U-S, Ohio, not Iowa. Mr. Katona is a businessman and part-time police officer. In 1990, ladies and gentlemen, the BATF raided his home. Now remember, he's a part-time police officer and a businessman. They raided his home, seizing his gun collection during the raid. Kimberly Katona, his pregnant wife, was shoved by a BATF agent against a wall and suffered a miscarriage right there on the spot. A federal judge dismissed all charges and ordered the collection returned. But nothing happened to these Gestapo Nazi jackbooted thugs.
Dragnet, their job, to enforce the law and preserve the safety of decent citizens. Decent citizens. Decent citizens. The story is Dragnet.
Well, our people covered this story. We had a man on the spot. Seems that in a local domestic dispute, some guy supposedly, this was what reported, made threats against his wife. She supposedly left the house, went to relatives and called the police, letting them know the teenage son was still in the house. All lies. Son wasn't in the house, didn't threaten his wife. As it turned out, the husband has a collection of firearms for which he has legal permits, but it seems like this fact made the cops decide they had an armed hostage situation. Except by the time they got there, the teenager wasn't in the house. He was sitting on the corner. So then the cops decided they had an armed standoff situation with a suicidal madman with what one news outlet claimed was a drug problem. Except, folks, this same news segment then interviewed the neighbors, who to a person, without exception, all said they knew the guy well and that he was very even-tempered and a really nice guy and had never evidenced behavior like this ever. Not particularly the description of a drug user. The drug supposedly being used was never mentioned, by the way, because there wasn't any. It was stated that the police had no record of any previous trouble with the guy, who was described as being on a leave of absence from his job working at the water treatment facility at UConn. And every family member stated that the guy definitely was not suicidal, and his nephew was shown on television as being really, really angry with the cops. His word, and I quote, was pissed off, end quote. Because he claimed the whole situation could be ended immediately if they just let him talk to his uncle, that he'd be able to get his uncle to leave the house within minutes of talking to him, but the cops wouldn't let him talk to his uncle. Meantime, inside, this guy was scared to death. He didn't know what was going on. All he knew is his house was surrounded by armed police officers and ninja-suited creeps, and there were actually men in position with rifles pointed at all the windows. He was scared to death. In the meantime, the cops forcibly evacuated the entire neighborhood and not only cut electricity to the house, but cable access also. Now, it seems to me, once the electricity is off, folks, that effectively cut the use of cable TV, so why go to that extreme? It was stated on the news that the cops wanted to eliminate his access to media reports. But what about battery-operated radio and television? And what's the logic behind eliminating the guy's access to media reports of the event? Maybe he could have understood a little bit better what was going on. And by the way, throughout this siege, this guy never once fired a shot. In fact, in the house, he never even once had a gun in his hands. He was described as in an agitated state. Well, folks, I gotta tell you, if my house was surrounded by SWAT team, ninja-suited, Gestapo, Nazi, jackbooted thugs, I'd be agitated too. If my neighbors were forcibly evicted and my electricity and cable cut off, I'd be damned agitated. And I'd be in fear of my life. It's a big difference between this fellow and me, though. I'd definitely have a gun in my hand. I wouldn't want to hurt anybody, and I probably would never shoot unless they shot at me first. But once they did that, what in the world would anybody expect anybody else to do? This fellow never even picked up a gun. About 20 hours after this all started, it was reported that the guy finally surrendered, has been taken to a local hospital for, guess what, folks, psychiatric evaluation.
facts, ma'am.
Oh, you guys think this is nothing, huh? Just a few isolated instances around the country. Folks, I'm looking at a stack of documents 8 inches thick. I could do this show for weeks and never finish. Never finish. Listen to this. Trenton, New Jersey. This happened, folks, in Trenton, New Jersey. Turtles. That's right. Turtles might move slowly, but they've been put on the fast track in court this week. A Superior Court judge has been asked to determine where some of the shelled creatures will live and who will take care of them. What am I talking about? Well, on May 18th, officers, police officers, and officers from the Division of Fish, Game, and Wildlife of the state's Department of Environmental Protection raided the home of Douglas N. Albert Jr., 33 years old, in Scotch Plains, Union County, and seized 26 bog turtles. Yep, that's right. Big Ninja Turtle raid. Can't believe it. Big Ninja Turtle raid, folks. They finally got it right. They raided the home of Douglas N. Albert Jr. and seized 26 turtles, which are on the endangered species list, but just in that state, you see. And that's not where he got them. And he wasn't endangering them. He was the only person who's ever succeeded in getting this endangered species to breed. The officers who conducted this raid were armed and even wore flak jackets. Can you imagine to seize 26 little bitty turtles from one guy who had finally gotten this endangered species to breed so that they could be preserved? One of them stepped on one of the turtles and squished it because they're only as big as the inside of your palm. That's as big as they ever get. Albert purchased the turtles lawfully from a Florida dealer where they are not endangered and has been doing it since the mid-1980s. He sued the DEP in an attempt to get these turtles back. The New York State Department of Environmental Conservation now has the turtles and is conducting scientific studies at the Bronx Zoo in New York, according to court documents. Now, bear in mind that these turtles are plentiful in Florida and are not endangered at all. But in New Jersey, they are. I can't continue with this story, folks. I just can't do it. It's 3 pages long. I can't do it. I am absolutely sorry. I can't do it. It's ridiculous. It is insane. New Orleans, Louisiana. You think the cops don't kill people? A policewoman was convicted Monday of killing a former partner and 2 other people during an attempted robbery at a restaurant. That's right. While she was off duty, she went in a restaurant and robbed it. Then later, when the people called the police and there were dead people there because she shot her own partner who answered the call and a couple of other people, well, she came back with the police who were investigating it, and the people who were robbed identified her. She was that stupid. And that's not all. That's not all. Antoinette Frank's case was the latest in a series of scandals for the New Orleans Police Department.
under fire not only for allegations of brutality and corruption, but also for the city's murder rate, which has risen consistently, and several police officers are under investigation for being the murderers. The city of fewer than 500,000 recorded 420 murders last year. The week Frank was arrested, there were 21 murders. Since 1993, ladies and gentlemen, at least 38 officers have been arrested, including 10 in a federal drug sting in December. One of the 10 has been accused by federal prosecutors of ordering the murder of a woman who filed a brutality complaint against him. Another officer who remains on the force at a desk job is a suspect, ladies and gentlemen, in the murders of 24 people since 1991, including his girlfriend and several prostitutes. Now, I don't know how you can sleep after all of this, and I could go on for weeks. I'm not kidding. I'm not joking at all. What's happening in this country is despicable. And I'm not joking at all when I tell you, you are in more danger from law enforcement people, from people wearing a badge, than you ever will be from a criminal. Right now, today, as I speak. I could literally continue giving you these reports for weeks. Without stop. Good night. And may God bless you all.
Dragnet. Their job, to enforce the law and preserve the safety of decent citizens. Decent citizens. Decent citizens.
Thank God it's Wednesday!